Okay, let's get started. Welcome to our webinar, and thank you for taking the time out of your day to join us. I see that people are logging in from all over the country today. Welcome. We partnered with the Options Industry Council to bring you this webinar on key points to know about selling options. My name is Gina Bocaius, and I'm on the management team of Regal Securities, which is the parent company of eOption and its sister company, InvestTrade. The session today will last approximately 1 hour. Our speaker will give his presentation for approximately 45 minutes, and the remainder will be for your questions. If you do have any questions during the presentation, please feel free to type them into the Q&A box, and our speaker will answer those at the end of his presentation. We ask that you don't enter your questions in the chat room if you'd like them answered by our speaker, as he won't see them, so please use the Q&A box. Also, you can reach out to eOption's trade desk at any time if you have any additional questions after the webinar. A recording of this session will be available on our YouTube channel tomorrow, so we encourage you to subscribe to eOption's YouTube channel so you'll have early access to it. At eOption, we have over 45 years of option trading expertise. We have one of the best stock and option trading platforms around, and all of our stock and ETF trades are just zero commission, and options are 10 cents per contract. We also offer many wonderful free tools, such as Options Play, which help you to generate option trading ideas, and that's normally a $500 value annually, but it's free for all eOption customers. So I'd like to turn our attention to our speaker now, Ed Modla from the Options Industry Council. Ed is currently Executive Director of Investor Education, and he's been in the options business for 24 years. He's been a popular speaker for eOption, and we're happy to welcome him back. So without further ado, I'll turn it over to Ed Modla. Thank you.
Thanks, Gina, and always good to be here. I can see we've got a nice large crowd, which I'm excited to see and looking forward to this topic, selling options from a mostly conceptual perspective, but we'll get into a few other things as well. As Gina said, I've been in the options business for 24 years from a few different angles, starting out as a professional options market maker in the open outcry environment on the trading floors in Chicago and New York. Spent a number of years trading electronically, that was options, stocks, and futures. And spent some time as a futures broker within that time frame. But now for almost 7 years, exclusively doing options education for OCC within their education department known as the Options Industry Council. Here is our disclaimer and where you can find more from us if you're interested in this type of session or other education that we have. First of all, we are not a broker. We have no brokerage services, no advisory services. We don't sell data. We actually don't sell anything. We just provide education through our website, optionseducation.org, former podcasts that we used to do, videos, webinars. Everything we do is funded by OCC. Those little transaction fees when you trade options, those go to OCC. They use those that revenue generated to manage risk in the industry and also to clear options. But some of that makes its way down to the Options Industry Council to provide this education. We've also got a team, a support team, five of us, former traders and brokers. You can contact us by email at options@theocc.com. If you're interested in the slides I'm using today or any questions about what we've got, feel free to send us an email. Here's our outline for today, and it's actually going to start somewhat basic. I don't like to spend too much time on the basics, but there'll be a little bit in there about rights and obligations, buyers versus sellers, and then we'll start to get into more of the conceptual aspects of selling options, premium, specifically the variables that go into pricing models, time value, volatility is going to come up quite a bit, and I will refer to the volatility skew on a number of occasions today. Also, exercise and assignment. Buyers have to know about exercise. Sellers need to know about assignment, particularly pin risk or after assignment risk. You certainly don't want to end up with a position that you don't want to have and a risk that you never intended to take. So we'll talk about assignment as well. Starting at the ground floor here with basics, just focusing on the calls to begin with. Super ground floor here, the fundamentals. A call buyer, like any other option buyer, is paying cash immediately out of their account. And in exchange for that, they now own an option, which has value and assets in their account. You would expect that the cash debit and the position credit mostly offset each other, not entirely, but mostly do offset each other. And now this investor owns the right to buy shares of stock at the strike price of the call option. Since they own the right to buy shares at a fixed price, if the shares were to rally in a bullish fashion, then you would expect or hope that this call option value would increase and the call buyer is attempting to profit off of just that. Stock movement being greater than the time decay or the natural erosion of the option value that the call buyer knows they are going to suffer. It's really a combination of those two things that will determine profitability. Now let's bring in the implied volatility discussion sort of right away here. And I'm going to start by drawing the volatility skew or the implied volatility curve that many of you are likely familiar with. If you were to plot implied volatility on the vertical axis against the strike prices on the horizontal, and we'll say we identify where the at-the-money strike price is, your traditional volatility skew, if you were to plot where these volatility levels sit in relation to their strike price, and then connect the dots, the most classic looking volatility skew, you know, looks something like this, where you have higher implied volatility levels at the lower strike prices, and these would be your put options below the strike. And then there's a bottoming out effect just above at the money. In simple terms, I've heard this explained, I think, accurately as the most calm, peaceful market environment that you're going to experience is the one that's just slowly, gradually moving higher. It's not moving nowhere. It's not moving lower. It's just slowly moving higher. And that is where implied volatility often bottoms out. And then if you get big moves to the upside, you sort of have this tapering out effect. This is your classic looking skew that you will undoubtedly find in index options and traditionally in most equity options. However, volatility skew is not defined this way. I'm going to draw in another example of how volatility skew could look. And we'll just say this underlying has higher volatility across the board. So I just drew it at a higher level, but it's also rather symmetrical. At least this was my attempt to be symmetrical around the strike price. Implied vol levels down here at lower strikes are rather at the same level as higher strikes. And you might say this has no skew to it. This has volatility levels that are rather equal on both sides. Traditionally, you might notice this often in commodities, say oil or gold, or if you follow futures markets, this would apply to soft markets like corn and wheat, the grains like corn and wheat, or the softs like sugar and cocoa, where you have symmetrical skew. These underlyings can move in either direction with the same amount of velocity. So speculating and protection is needed on both sides. And you see this in equities as well. And when a particular underlying has reached a level where the demand for both the calls and puts is about the same. And I'm just going to draw on one more skew here. And this is the inverted skew, the purple line here. Volatility skew can take on all of these forms. This skew with implied vol levels much higher for calls than puts is known as inverted. You would expect to see this for an underlying whose performance is the inverse of the overall market. Think VIX, for example. You know, VIX today, I haven't checked it within the last few minutes, but somewhere around 16 or so, 15, 16, as we speak. If you were to look down at the put options at the 13, 12, or 11 strike, and say you go out a few weeks, you know, 2 or 3 weeks to expiration, you're looking at the 12 strike, 13 strike, there's going to be nothing there, no bids there, because VIX really doesn't get down that far. It doesn't stay down. It doesn't drop below those levels. There's not much demand for puts, very low prices, very low implied vol. On the flip side, with VIX trading 15 or 16, if you were to go up to the 30 level or 25 level, you would see bids. The VIX, of course, can move higher much more sharply than it moves lower. And so you have higher prices for calls, higher demand, and therefore this inverted skew. Equity options can take on any of these forms, depending on current circumstances. Where is the demand? Which direction are investors looking to either speculate or protect? I'm mentioning all this here because call buying often drives where this is. And in the past year, 18 months, we've seen a lot more equities exhibit symmetrical skews or inverted skews because call buying has come to fruition. It's been a bit more popular strategy than perhaps I've ever seen in my years in the business. But we're here to focus on selling options. So let's get there. Right now, an equity call seller is going to receive cash immediately into their account. That's cash credit. Their cash position goes up. In exchange for that, they've taken on the obligation to sell shares of stock. That will go into their account as a short position and will be a debit. So again, those two dollar amounts mostly will offset each other. The cash position increase, and then the short position in your account, the short open option as a debit, somewhat cancel each other out. Now, this call seller, if this is all they're doing is selling calls, likely already owns shares of stock. And this is because if they didn't own shares of stock, then the risk of this call seller, called a naked call, would be very similar to shorting shares of stock, but with very limited profit potential. If you short stock, you have upside risk. It's going to look exactly the same if you sell a naked call. The difference is short stock can profit handsomely if the shares sell off. Call option is only going to profit its premium. That's its maximum potential gain. Let's look a little deeper on the two call strategies that we've just outlined. I'm sure many of you are familiar with covered calls. So I'm not going to spend too much time explaining that there's two pieces here, owning shares and selling usually an out-of-the-money call option to receive premium and getting this, this blue risk profile with a lowered break-even point and capped gains here to the upside as you've taken on the obligation to sell the 80 strike. Strike selection, normally here when you're selling options, just generally speaking, you're trying to select the option that's going to give you the most value, the most premium at that price that you do not think the stock is going to go through. So in this case, we think the stock's going to go to 80. We want to capture that $5 move on the shares we own. We don't think it's going higher than 80. So we don't think we're going to give up this gain to the upside up at 85 or 90 or higher. We don't think that's going to happen. So we're willing to sell at the 80 level. If another investor identified 85 as their resistance point and thought shares might get there to 85, then they might look higher and sell shares up at this level. Sell the call option up at this strike price level. The other thing, again, focusing up here, when you're managing covered calls, one thing to keep an eye on when you have this position open, you have a short option, we're trying to capture time value. When we sold this option, $1.80 is all time value. That's what we want. We want that decay, that natural erosion of the option premium's time value. Once that is gone, we can't make more on the options piece. If that happens to occur with the stock above 80, with the option in the money, once time value is gone, we've maximized our gains. If the stock was at 90, what we would want to do is track the value of our 80 call option. If it's trading 990 bid offered at 1010, all the time value is gone. All of the value that's left is intrinsic value. At that point in time, we would have all risk and no further potential reward. That's a good time to consider trading out of the position and moving your capital somewhere else. Now, if the stock was at 90 and we looked at the 80 call and it was 1040 bid offered at 1060, midpoint there, 10 and a half, we can quickly calculate there's 50 cents left of time value there. $10 of that is intrinsic. The other 50 cents is time value. So if we hold the position and do nothing and the stock does nothing, or at least stays above 80, we still have 50 cents more to gain. And that's something to consider when you're managing the position and tracking. What do I have left? Instead of just holding until expiration, it might make more sense to close once the time value has disappeared and move your capital somewhere else. Sticking with selling calls, we're now going to look at the bear call spread. It involves two pieces, selling the lower strike call for a higher amount of premium, and then covering all of that upside risk by buying a higher strike call at a higher level. You're going to precisely be able to calculate your max gain and max loss here. And that's why vertical spreads of this, which is one, is a popular strategy for investors. Sell one of the 50 calls for $1.65. That obligates the investor to sell shares at 50 and then cover that risk buying one of the 52 half calls for 65 cents. The credit is the difference between the two. And the worst case situation is if the stock goes above 52 half, we would have to sell stock at 50. We have the right to buy it back. We're giving back $2.50 to the market. And when you consider the credit up front, that means max loss $1.50. The stock stays below our short strike of 50. Then we have max gain of $1. And notice, because we do a credit spread and the max profit is less than our maximum loss, what we would expect is to have a greater likelihood of success, or a very strong likelihood of success, because we stand to lose more than we can make. And with credit spreads, this is one of the characteristics. Stocks at 50, if the stock goes nowhere, we maximize our profit. If the stock drops, we of course also maximize our profit. We can actually be wrong by 2%. Remember, we're thinking this is bearish. We're thinking the stock's either going to be neutral or, if anything, go lower. If we're wrong by 2%, then we break even. And hopefully you would consider that a strong likelihood of being successful. Hence, the risk-reward ratio is a bit skewed against us. And that's the opposite characteristic when you're buying options. You would expect likelihood of profitability to be less, but your maximum gain more than max loss. When you're selling options, it's the opposite. Let's take a look at put options from the more simple perspective. A put buyer pays cash out of their account. They own the right to sell shares of stock at the strike price. They own that right till expiration. They could be speculating, hoping the stock drops, the option value goes up. They could be protecting shares they own, owning the right to sell the stock that they own at a certain strike price. A couple of different popular motivations from the put buyer's perspective. Particularly with this buying protection aspect for investors, for money managers, for institutional investors, this demand coming from protecting positions and protecting portfolios, that's where that traditional volatility skew that I talked about before, that's where that comes from. Higher demand for puts, protection from, through the purchase of puts, not really protection from buying calls. Buying calls is more speculative, and that's why that traditional volatility skew is most often in place. An equity put seller, we're focused on the sell side here today, so we'll take a look, receives a cash credit immediately and now has the obligation to buy shares of stock at the strike price of the option. Similar to calls, they will have an increase in their cash position in their account, and then the short open option will be also included in their account as a debit. The amount of the debit is going to be the value of the option. That could be the midpoint, that could be the offer price, depends how your firm looks at that, but it'll be a debit. And those two pieces, the cash credit and the debit, will likely offset each other, not 100%, but very close to that. And the put seller outright, we'll look at it this more in just a second, is likely interested in generating income, waiting for the share price to drop. So let's take a look at that. Out of a risk profile, we have the stock trading at 81, and this investor likes the shares. They want the shares, but they're not too comfortable at 81. Maybe the shares, for example, are dropping from 85, and they're watching 84, 83, 82, 81, and just happening a little too quick. They're not quite ready to pull the trigger. So instead of watching the shares or working a limit order to buy somewhere, this investor sells a put option. They select the 80 strike, so close to where the stock currently is. It's fairly volatile. We're going to go out 47 days till expiration and get a nice healthy premium of $3.90 to sell this put option. Now, at expiration, if we were assigned and had to buy the stock, we're paying $80, but we received $3.90 up front. So our cost basis here is $76.10. the ideal situation is that the stock's trading 79, 78, 77, and our cost basis is 76.10. And we can then manage the position that is already in a profitable position. Strike selection here can be a little tricky. I mentioned limit order before. Now, these are cash secure puts are not exactly like limit orders. If the stock were to come down here to the 80 level and just touch the 80 price, and you're working a limit order to buy shares, you're going to get filled. You're going to get the shares that you want. If the stock touches 80 and then rallies above that, or even drops below 80 and rallies back above all before expiration, it's a good chance your put option was not assigned and you don't have shares of stock that you wanted. That's a key difference to watch. Now, you certainly could take some action on that if the stock was trading at 78 and started to rally and you've got another couple of weeks till expiration and you're thinking, I really want the stock here. It doesn't look like I'm going to get it because it's going to go back above 80. I'm not going to get a sign. I'm not going to get the shares. You know, if you're in that situation, you can evaluate whether or not you want to be aggressive. If you did, you would buy to close the option that you sold, hopefully for no more than you received for it, but buy to close the option and then just go ahead and buy the shares in the open market. And now you've got them. You don't have to worry about losing the stock if you really think it's going to start rallying sharply. Consolation prize, if that happens, you don't get the shares, they rally, you miss that big move, and at least you got the 390, and that's going to be profit. That's going to be income and realized profit if you are not assigned. Bull put spread is the vertical, similar to the call bulls, bear call spread, where your credits and selling options. Here we've got bull put spreads, selling the more expensive higher strike put, buying a lower strike put. Stock's at 115, and we're going to sell the 115 put. We think the stock's going to rally from here, but we don't know when. We're not sure how far, so we don't want to spend all the money on buying shares. We don't want to buy any calls because we really don't know when this is going to happen, but we do want to capitalize. We want to make something on this because we're pretty sure 115 is a strong support level. It's not going to be broken. So you might sell the 115 put for $2. But if something bad happens, if that support does happen to break, this thing could really get ugly. So in order to protect the downside risk of having to buy shares at 115, we buy the 110 puts, giving us the right to sell shares down at that level. And we pay for that, 70 cents. The net credit between the two is $1.30. And now we can see with the stock up above 115, both options expire worthless. With the stock below 110, we're obligated to buy shares at 115. We have the right to sell them back at 110, giving back $5 to the market minus our credit. And there's your max loss of $3.70. One thing I do want to mention here, for those of you who are familiar with synthetics, the bull put spread is synthetic to the bull call spread, the debit version or buying version of the bull call spread. And it's a rather interesting thing if you're not familiar. Let's just look at this example right here, but talk about it in terms of buying a call spread. We have the 110-115 strike. And on the put side, we sold it for $1.30. You can see how this comes out with max profit, max loss. Now, what if this was the 110-115 call spread and we bought it for $3.70? Think about that. If the stock was above 115, we'd reach our maximum gain. We can buy shares at 110. We're obligated to sell them here at 115. We take $5 out of the market. We paid $3.70 up front, max profit, $1.30. The stock drops below 110. Again, we're long the call spread. Both options expire out of the money and worthless. We paid $3.70. We lose $3.70. It's the same exact trade. These are synthetics to each other, given the same strike prices and given the execution prices I just outlined. I didn't randomly pick 370, of course, for our purchase price of the call spread. I picked it to match up to where the put spread was trading. I mentioned this just in case you come across some guidance or maybe a trade advice that says, well, we're interested in buying this call spread. We think the stock's going to stay above the level, and it's an in-the-money strike call spread. We're going to pay $4. Both strikes are in the money, and we think the stock's going to stay above that level, and you're going to have a very good chance to make a dollar after spending four. You know, if that type of trade is out there, the first thing I'm going to look at is, well, what's the put spread trading for? I can do the same exact trade, same exact risk profile, but if I can sell the put spread for $1.10, then the put spread is actually mathematically superior to the call spread. Instead of paying four to potentially make one, I'm going to sell the put spread and make $1.10 potentially, risking $3.90. So one could be superior to the other, depending on execution prices. Something to keep in mind there when you're thinking about selling versus buying. Let's shift more into the conceptual aspects of the presentation here. First, with option premium, which at its most basic level can be broken into two pieces. An options premium consists of intrinsic value, if any. Only in the money options will have intrinsic value. Those are call options with a strike price below where the stock is trading, meaning the call buyer has the right to purchase shares at a better level than where the stock currently is. Or for put options, these are strike prices above where the stock currently is, where the put buyer has the right to sell shares at a price better than where the current open market value for the shares is. For those in the money options, intrinsic value is calculated as the difference between stock price and strike price. Outside of intrinsic value, whether it exists or whether it's zero, any remaining value in the option is considered time value. This is also called extrinsic value, calling it time value here, which has a number of components to it. The days to expiration, an implied volatility assumption, interest rates, and dividends. When you look across the board here at these inputs, we can observe all of them except for one. We know what the stock price currently is, and we can track that. We know what strike price we're looking at. We know what the days to expiration is. Everybody knows what the risk-free interest rate, they can look up the risk-free interest rate between today and expiration. We know what dividends are expected to be paid. Volatility is what we don't know. And volatility is simply driven by supply and demand, the dynamics between buyers and sellers in the options market. More buyers moving prices higher, implied volatility goes up. More sellers driving options prices lower, volatility goes down. That's something that changes constantly throughout the day. Now, with all of these inputs, the output, which I'm not going to draw in here, but the output of this is the option value, the theoretical or hypothetical option value. We can also observe that. We can look in the open market and see, where's it trading? What's the bid? What's the offer? What's the midpoint? We can observe that and insert the option value into the pricing model. I should have mentioned all of these are the inputs to the pricing model. We can insert all of these values, including the option value, and back solve for volatility. And that leads me to the explanation that one of the definitions for implied volatility is the volatility level that justifies a given options price, because we can observe where the option price is. A little bit more to come on this as I walk through it. Let's talk about time decay and volatility as well. First, theta is the Greek expression that measures an option value's sensitivity to time. It's the passage of one day. It's per calendar day, not trading day. Some option sellers might think they can sell options on Friday afternoon and capture a quick 3 days of decay. It's possible, but you have to be careful there. And I reflect on my days back on the trading floor in the late 90s, early 2000s. We know what day of the week it is. We know when there's a holiday or a weekend coming up as professional traders. And we don't want to be buying options all day on Friday. So one of the things we would do as professionals, at some point on Friday, maybe late morning, maybe early afternoon, we would start to tick down the days to expiration and change them. And it was still Friday, but we could change the days to expiration 3 days less and start to run calculations to get theoretical values upon which we made markets. We calculated our bids and offers, but based on option values that were more reflective of Monday than they were a Friday. And we did that again, because we didn't want to be buying options all day on Friday. So if we're going to look at a little bit lower value. So keep in mind, that's the case, but also, I will say, if you are selling options at the end of the week, you're taking more risk. I think the market moves based on any news that comes out, whether it's from an economic perspective or a political or a military perspective, anywhere around the world, things can happen that move the market. And if you're open with short risk positions over the weekend, you are taking 3 days of risk versus one. by selling over a weekend. Just a few things to consider when you have that per calendar day aspect that includes weekends and you know 3 days are coming out there. Calls and puts both have negative theta amounts. That is certainly true for equity options. I won't get too deep into this, but I always like to point out, it's rather interesting, you can look this up a little further if you would like. It is possible for European options to have the opposite theta. You could, in theory, buy an option that whose value increases with each passing day and gravitates up towards its intrinsic value. The classic example that you could notice today, if you went out and looked on options chains, is for deep in the money European put options. Think about what a put option means. If you own a put option, you have the right to sell at the strike price and get cash into your account. If it's a very valuable, a deep in the money put option, 100 delta, and you hold the put, you have this valuable put that's not doing anything for you. If it was an equity, an American style option, you might want to exercise that, get the cash into your account so you can then utilize the cash. That's beneficial for you. If it's European, you can't do that. You don't have the choice. European does not allow you to exercise early. So for those deep, deep in the money put options that are European style, buyers are not willing to pay intrinsic value because they're stuck with the put. They can't exercise early. Sellers might actually be willing to sell underneath intrinsic value because they know they're going to get cash today from selling the option and they can't be assigned early. So I think it's a rather interesting example of that specific circumstance there where you can actually have a long options position that is a positive theta and a short options position as negative theta. But again, that's the unique circumstance there specific to European options where early exercise is not possible. Now, both option buyers and sellers are familiar with this 40 days until expiration level where for at-the-money options, and I use this term loosely, these are the strike prices that are somewhat rather close to where the stock price is currently trading, where you have that acceleration of decay. Now, for in-the-money, and this also applies for out-of-the-money options that have far, far less time value to begin with, you have a more linear, not exactly linear, but more linear rate of decay. But for at-the-money, where all the action is, all the trading is, you have this 40 days until expiration, roughly, where time decay begins to accelerate, and it continues to accelerate all the way through expiration day. You will not get faster decay than you will on expiration day when all time value disappears. 100% rate of decay of time value on expiration day. Option sellers are trying to capture the fastest rate of decay they can, but they also have to go out far enough so that the option premium itself that they're selling is worth it to them. It might not be worth selling an option that's trading for a nickel just to get 100% decay. That risk might not be worth it. So you have to go out far enough to get a decent amount of premium and then try to capture decay. You don't see too many option sellers go out too much further than that 40-day level, particularly when they're trying to capture time decay, because that rate of erosion is just very, very slow. So that 40-day level, give or take, you'll hear different numbers, is where that starts. Now, implied volatility, compared to historical volatility, is looking into the future. Historical volatility is just a reflection of stock prices. From today, looking back at what the stock had done over the past 10 days, 30 days, 90 days, it's up to you what range you want to look at, but it's historical. It's factual, it's known, looking back what the stock has already done. Implied volatility is specific to options. And it's a volatility level that's used in the pricing models, we talked about that, to come up with theoretical or hypothetical values for what the option is worth given a certain level of volatility driven by supply and demand. Now, these two numbers don't necessarily go in tandem the way you see here. I'm just gonna draw in, we'll say another stock. We'll say this first line that we're looking at here is stock A, and I'm going to draw in stock B here that has all over the place. Much more higher volatility, much more movement. and is all over the place. Stock B is just wildly moving. Now, if this is all the information we had, stock A in the black line, stock B in the red line, and you were trying to price options moving forward, we had no other information, you might say, well, I'm pricing options on stock B much higher because the volatility is much, much greater. And granted, that makes sense, but we always know more than just this. Stock B might have had earnings somewhere in here, and it caused all this. And again, sorry about that. That just got a little crazy there. But stock B might have had earnings, and that drove all this action. And now it's starting to settle down. And stock, this black line stock, I may have said it backwards, stock A here, back and forth, sort of sticking in the mud here. Maybe it's waiting for earnings. Earnings are about to come out. Now, if you had that information, then you might price options on stock A much greater than stock B. So historical volatility plays a role. It can be useful, and traders do look at it and use it. But you do have to take the full context of what's going on in the market in mind. And that, looking forward, is going to include a lot more than just historical volatility and the supply and demand dynamics. The difference, where are there more buyers and sellers, more sellers and buyers? Where is that coming from? That ultimately is what's going to determine implied volatility levels. All other pricing factors remaining constant. It makes perfect sense that as implied volatility increases, then the expected potential future range of stock prices also goes up on both sides, upside and downside. So call and put prices both increase. As implied volatility decreases, then the future potential range of expected stock prices decreases or shrinks on both sides, upside and downside. So both call and put prices will decrease. Also, with respect to time, the longer dated options are going to be more sensitive to changes in implied volatility, either up or down. If you changed the volatility assumption of the shares by 1% and you only had one day left until expiration, that doesn't do a whole lot for the potential stock prices moving out one day. So those option values are not going to change a whole lot. As you go out further in time, 1% change for options that expire in 12 months will certainly change the potential range of where that stock may end up a full year from now with a new volatility level spread across that entire year. So the sensitivity to option prices with respect to changes in volatility are greater for longer term options than they are for shorter term. One other thing about volatility I'm going to discuss here with respect to a hypothetical situation centered around earnings. Here we have a stock at 100. We have a couple of weeks till expiration. And before earnings, implied volatility is at 50%. And here's where the call values are. You have your Greek values here, but let's just focus on the call value of $1.85 prior to earnings. You know, it is common in the days and possibly few weeks prior to earnings for implied volatility to drift higher, to slowly drift higher. And that doesn't necessarily mean option prices are going higher. And when I say this, some investors think, well, couldn't I just buy options a few weeks before earnings and then sell options a day or two before and make money that way? And the answer is not necessarily. It certainly might not work out that way because implied volatility going up doesn't mean that the option value is necessarily going higher if days to expiration are shrinking. If from one day to the next, the value of this call option is $1.85, so 12 days left, it's still here at $1.85. 11 days left, it's still here at $1.85. Think back a few slides ago when I walked through the pricing model inputs, strike price, stock price, days to expiration, volatility, interest rates, dividends, and you get the option value. Think about all of those inputs. The strike price isn't changing. Stock price isn't changing. The days to expiration is shrinking. Going to leave volatility alone for a second. Dividends and interest rates aren't changing. The option value is also not changing. Nothing is changing except days to expiration are going down. Therefore, just for the math to work, implied volatility has to go higher with less days till expiration and option values holding steady, all else equal, implied volatility will go up. not because the option value is going higher, but because there are fewer days until expiration. Often that is what you're seeing leading up to earnings announcements when implied volatilities are drifting higher. The value could go up, but not necessarily the case. After earnings, you are likely going to see volatility greatly reduced as the uncertainty of an earnings announcement has now been removed. So we have the stock going up 5%, but now 10 days later, and with implied volatility much lower, even though we got a 5% move in our favor, the value of the call option is less. Now, this is not to say that buying options before earnings doesn't work. It certainly can. But in this case, we just needed bigger than 5% move. And as an options investor, you would want to know that. As an options seller, you would want to know that. What type of risk do I have given various levels of volatility? Now, how can you forecast? Where's volatility going to be after earnings? Well, this is where it gets tricky, of course. But if you are familiar with a particular stock or underlying, you may have witnessed previous earnings announcements. Where was implied vol before the announcement? Where was it after? And you can go back the last year, last 2 years, last 3 years, and see what type of changes in implied volatility there were. And then go to an options calculator and plug that in. Now, every situation, of course, is different. Every earnings announcement is not the same. There could be more emphasis on this one than the previous one, or less emphasis on this one than previous ones. And of course, when you have more immature companies, say IPOs, who don't have a history of earnings, then of course you have more uncertainty there. When you come across those situations, that's when you see wider markets, when even the market professionals don't really know where's implied vol going before earnings, after earnings, and there's uncertainty by everybody, even the professionals. That is when you will start to see wider bid-ask spreads. And that's generally true with options across the board. When there's more uncertainty, when there's more panic, market participants start to drop off. Professionals really aren't sure what's going on and where things are going to go. Some markets widen out a little bit. Once that uncertainty is removed, then the markets tighten back up. Now let's talk about the assignment process most specifically. First, by just stating that buyers have rights, sellers have obligations. We've talked about that. Option buyers exercise their rights, and then sellers are on the other side subject to assignment. Being a little bit of a summary of what we talked about earlier, option sellers take on obligations to sell stock for a call option or buy shares of stock for a put option. And that's if they're assigned an exercise or assignment notice and they're received from the brokerage firm. We'll get through the communication lines here in a second, but only option sellers are assigned, and you can't ask to be assigned. You can't ask to be a request to be at the front of the line or the back of the line. It is a random process of assignment that starts with OCC, the clearing corporation, who knows what all of the open positions are at the firm level. Your trading accounts are not with OCC. So the clearing corp doesn't know what positions you have in your individual account, but they do know what positions are held by the firm. So OCC, upon assignment, will go through a random assignment process, notifying clearing member firms. This is the information OCC has. What positions are open at the firm level? And we'll notify these firms that they have been assigned. Then there's a second level or a second tier of assignment that occurs, which could involve brokerage firms who are further assigned and then communicating to traders. Your account could be with either or, doesn't really matter where it is. But eventually, from one way or another, investors and traders are informed of their assignment that starts with OCC and then goes through your firm and comes down to you. Both of these random assignment processes are, of course, regulated and approved by industry regulators, and investors or traders will want to know, when am I informed of my assignment? How am I informed of my assignment? Particularly when you're unsure about assignment, and that brings me to the last concept for today, which is pin risk. When you're a seller, you have to know that there is always going to be some level of uncertainty over whether or not you're going to be assigned. I mean, if nothing else, maybe the option holder makes a mistake. You could be assigned. Now, if they make a mistake, it's probably a good thing for you to be assigned. But what is pin risk? Mostly it occurs when the stock settles close to the strike price at expiration. The risk is in this uncertainty that the seller has of whether or not the option will finish in the money or whether or not they'll just be assigned. It doesn't have to finish in the money. They're not sure if it will or not, but even if it doesn't, the option seller could be assigned by just simply because the option holder decides that's what they'd like to do, whether it's in their financial best interest or not. It is important because you may end up with a position that you don't want to have that leaves you with overnight gap risk. It could leave you with a commitment of capital that you didn't intend to have. I've spoken to many investors, you know, clearly those who are fairly, well, not necessarily new to options, but maybe they've never experienced a situation where they were assigned when they didn't expect to be, or the opposite of that. They fully expected assignment. It didn't happen. And in my many years trading options, I could probably count on my fingers how many times that has happened, but it's happened. One of them stands out to me. I had a covered long share position, short a call. The option was maybe 50 cents in the money based on the strike price versus where the share price closed on expiration day, 50 cents. Okay, this position's over. I'm going to get assigned. I'm just going to let it go. But there was after hours activity. Share price dropped. I didn't get assigned. I still had the shares. Monday morning rolled around and the stock was down significantly and I was losing money on the trade. You know, you learn those lessons. You know, you should get out of those positions when you have something that's relatively close, but it can happen. And that's what pin risk is. And just a quick example of that, you have an option seller, similar to what I had just explained, short a 270 put heading into the closing bell. Now, if assigned, that's a lot of shares to buy. This option seller, I've talked to people who are looking at this and they're seeing where the stock, where's the share price? Heading into the closing bell, it's at 270 and a half, the 270 and a quarter, at 271. They're feeling, I'm good, I'm okay. Closing bell goes off and the stock closes, you know, somewhere above 270. And this seller thinks they're fine, they're good. It closed a quarter above my strike. I'm not going to get assigned here. It's not necessarily true. If there's something after hours or for whatever reason, the option holder decides they do want to exercise their option, they can. That's what they paid for. They paid for rights. They can exercise the put. You could still be assigned and have to buy shares that you didn't expect to have. And then you've got a position you don't want to have. Commitment of capital, risk profile, and positions that you likely don't want to have risk for. When you're selling options, from an educator's perspective, there's always some level of uncertainty over whether or not you're going to be assigned. Sometimes you're 99% certain and you think to yourself, even if I'm assigned, I'm happy with that. But when you have the stock close to the strike, you really don't know. Now, how close do you have to be concerned with? Well, that depends on how volatile the underlying is. For some underlying, say stocks, maybe if they're trading at $25 a share, 50 cents is going to be a lot. You know, you might not be too uncomfortable expecting what's going to happen if you're looking at something that's 50 cents in or out of the money. But if you have a stock trading at $500 a share and it's 50 cents one way or the other going into the closing bell, that's a different story. You really don't know if you're going to be assigned there. So pin risk somewhat depends on what price the actual shares are going at or how volatile they might be. So let me put up the closing slide as I take a look to see if we have any questions in here. So let's see what we've got. What is your expiration date on these trades? Now, how far do you go out? So we're focused on selling today, and I'm going to go back to the time decay slide. Let me find that. So for option sellers, you are often looking, at least starting at this 40-day level. But again, for more, you know, a lot of option sellers like to say, well, I want the fastest rate of decay I can. So I like to sell weekly, 2 weeks out, 3 weeks out to get faster decay. And if I can sell an option a week out, you know, 4-5 times, I'm going to get more premium out of that than if I just went 5 weeks out. Well, that's true if the stock doesn't move. And you have to say, if the stock doesn't move, that is true, but we don't know if the stock's going to move or not. So you're starting at this 40-day level. Maybe you can go a little out of there, a little in from here. At some point, for most equities, at some point here, the premium just isn't there. There just won't be enough premium. So it's hard for me to say what the expiration date is. And a few of my examples, I think I identified somewhere around this 40-day level. Certainly, you can sell weekly options. You can sell options with 3 days to go, with 5 days to go to expiration. But when you do so, it's because you're getting premium that you consider worth it. That usually happens when the underlying is more volatile. You know, the options market does not give away anything for free. So if you're getting a good amount of premium with very few days left till expiration, it might be worth taking a step back wondering, why am I getting this premium that looks really good to me? It looks very strong to me. Maybe there's something else going on. So it's, you know, what expiration date from one trade to the next, to the next, to the next, you're going to pick different levels. Inevitably, you're going to select a weekly over here. You're going to select a monthly over here. So really it all depends on that, but not too much further from that 40-day level is when you're going to go out. Let's see what else we have. When selling options, what's the benefit of selecting the strike at a 50% versus 25%? Well, this, you know, if you go back to that volatility classic looking curve, I'm not going to draw the whole thing up here, but just, you know, looking at the curve in a broad sense, you know, you have that classic looking volatility curve. And let's say this is going to say 50% up here, 25% down here. Well, certainly these options are considered more expensive because their volatility levels are higher. And if you're a vol seller, you would tend to lean that way. But so many people, even money managers, have gotten into trouble continuing to look at these high implied vol levels and say, those are more expensive. I want to sell those options. Remember what I said earlier about implied vol changing over time and maybe increasing, not because the prices of the options are changing, but because days to expiration are changing. The same thing can happen here with put options. I'm glad this question was asked because it is common, I'm going to try to draw this in, it is common to see volatility curves over time change such like this. This is the same stock, same expiration, but this black line might be 2 weeks to go to expiration and the red line might be 1 week to go to expiration. This is very common. You'll see this a lot. And down here, we're more or less tending to overlap. I'm drawing my attention up here. The steepening of this curve is the result of these put options trading way down here for a nickel, for a dime, for a quarter that don't change. Every single day you're looking at them, they're trading for a nickel today, a nickel tomorrow, nickel, nickel, nickel. They never change. Same thing with the dime. Those cheap put options, buyers still have bids there. Sellers do not lower their offers from one day to the next, to the next, to the next. What does that mean? Days to expiration are decreasing. Nothing else is changing. Option price is the same. Implied vol has to go up. And so this steepening of the curve is a common thing that you will observe as expiration approaches across equities. So what's the benefit of selecting a strike at 50%? You're trying to capture what you would say, most people would say, is a more expensive option that has a greater likelihood of success with what we say is juicier premiums. That's why you're looking for one vol versus another. But you have to keep this in mind. Just going to the highest level of implied vol is probably not the most prudent way to approach your strike selection. Be aware of both. Now, if you're looking at two different stocks, and this is a different question than what was being asked, but two different stocks, then you have a completely different analysis. Implied vol of 50% on one stock versus 25 on another, you've got to do some further due diligence there. The market is pricing in one stock being twice as volatile as the other. Does that make sense? Or are you comfortable selling that 50% high vol because you don't think that's the case? Maybe not. And I've certainly taken trades myself, intentionally selecting the lower implied vol level because that underlying did not appear to be too volatile. A lot less risk for a little bit less premium. Sometimes that's the way to go. Let's see, what else do we have? Pin risk. Got a question about pin risk. Let's see what this is. In the pin scenario, because somebody doesn't want to take that risk at the end. Will he close the position willing to lose some money not to run that risk? Yeah, it's possible. Now, if you've sold an option and you're dealing with pin risk, hopefully you're not in a position of having to take a loss here. If the stock is really, really close to where your strike price is, then hopefully the premium is also very low. Just speaking from experience, when you're in that circumstance, you know, I'd have to say far more often than not, closing the position isn't going to cost much and you're going to be able to lock in some profit. But investors sometimes, they don't even want to pay a dime. They don't even want to pay a quarter or 50 cents to get rid of that option. They think, I want the rest of that. I want 100% of my return. And that's where they start to get into trouble. They're not willing to spend a small amount to eliminate this pin risk, this assignment uncertainty risk. And instead they leave the position open and more times than not, it probably works out in their favor. But when it doesn't work out in their favor, that one time out of 10 where something bad does happen, it could wipe out all of those nickels and dimes that you tried to squeeze out. There's a phrase, I don't use this too often, but I've heard it float around the industry. You know, when in doubt, close them out. I've had a few colleagues that have said that often to as an educator. When in doubt about assignment or not, am I going to get assigned? I really don't know. And if I can't tolerate it, and I don't want it. When in doubt, close them out, buy to close, be done with it. And don't worry about paying those small pocket change amounts to close them back. Let's see, how important is using implied volatility in selling options? It depends. You know, some investors focus heavily on it, some don't. If you are focused on implied volatility, you might want to use some measurement to determine where our current levels of implied volatility compared to past levels of itself. You might look at something, you might discover your own method of analysis on that. You could look at pricing charts for that. You might look up, iVol percentile. There's a few dangling metrics out there that might help you determine some form of opinion on where is implied today versus where implied has been previously. And then if you think it's high or low, you can adjust your trading strategies. Now, yes, the question here, you know, generally you sell high vol and buy low vol. True. That is absolutely true. But the thing is, if vol is high, who's to say it doesn't stay that way or even go higher? That's the point to drive home. Even if you look and you say, wow, volatility is higher today than it's been all year, this past year, further scrutinize that and ask why. Because if it's at its all-time highs, you know, stocks, for example, they set all-time highs. That doesn't mean they're turning around. That means they can possibly continue to set new highs and all-time highs. And implied volatility can do the same thing. So yes, you do want to generally sell high implied vols and buy low implied vols. But that analysis is not simple. It's not clean. And some investors may determine that they are going to lean more on their market directional opinion. They might look at those vertical spreads. When you do a vertical spread, remember you're buying one, selling the other. That mitigates your exposure to volatility. Changes in volatility are going to affect both of those options, one in a positive way, one in a negative way. So you know, you can look at vertical spreads, try and take some of that volatility component out of it. But yeah, each investor may look at that a little bit differently. So we're right up against time here, and I do want to bring Gina back in for closing remarks, but thanks for all the participation. Great questions. I hope everyone enjoyed the session and learned something. And Gina, I will turn it over to you to close it up.
Okay, great. Well, thank you so much, Ed. That was very interesting and informative. And I really like that phrase, when in doubt, close it out. And thank you to all of our attendees for being here today and for their excellent questions. And just a few closing remarks. We encourage you to check out our website at www.eoption.com for more information on option trading. And we have lots of free resources on there for you. We have past webinars, videos, we have clickable option strategy links, we have a free guide. So it's a great way to get started and learn more about option trading. We also hope that you'll follow us on Facebook and subscribe to our YouTube channel. You'll get advance notice of webinars and investing tips. We also give you a lot of market updates, so we hope you'll check those out. And if you don't have an account yet, you can go to www.eoption.com and see what we have to offer. We do have a powerful trading platform and mobile app. And in fact, I just got a call from a customer today who was just telling me how much he loved our trading platform and how easy it was to use. And it was customizable and he just was so excited to use it. So I hope that you'll check us out, and you can also open a paper trading account if you wanna test it before you open an account, but there is no minimum to get started. Another benefit of eOption is we do offer zero commission on all stock and ETF trades, and options are just 10 cents per contract. And we also offer lots of free tools and ways for you to generate trading ideas, such as options play. We have a stock scanner. We offer unlimited free research reports and so much more. So we hope that you'll check us out and go to eOption.com. And last, the last point on the slide is join us for our next webinar, which will be Wednesday, September 29th at 1 p.m. Central Time. It's called Kick Off Your Fall with Backspread Option Strategies. And so you can just go to that eoption.com/webinars and reserve your spot today. And so again, thank you so much for your time. We appreciate you being here with us, and please be safe. Bye now.